Chapter 25 of The Great White Queen by William LeCue. Chapter 25. Leola. After brief consultation, it was deemed insecure for us to return to Goliba's house. A search would undoubtedly be made for us there if any had detected his presence with us in the great chasm. Therefore our guide, taking one of the lamps, led us along a number of narrow unlighted passages, threading the maze with perfect knowledge of its intricacies until, opening a door, we found ourselves in a small stone prison chamber. Here we remained while he went to another part of the vaults and obtained for us some food, urging us to remain there until such time as we might come forth in safety. Kona extracted from him a promise that he would place his fellow tribesmen in a place of security, and Goliba also assured us that if we remained in that chamber and did not attempt to wander in the passages where we must inevitably lose our way, we might ere long ascend to the city and commence the campaign against the cruel command of the merciless Naya. Through 11 long and dreary days we remained in the narrow cell, drawing our water from a spring that gushed forth from a rock close to the door, existing on the smallest quantity of food, and scarce daring to speak aloud lest any of the jailers should overhear. By day a faint light came through a narrow chink above, and from the fact that the steady tramp of soldiers sounded overhead at intervals, we concluded that the chamber must be situated immediately below one of the courtyards of the palace. At night, however, we remained in perfect darkness, our oil having been exhausted during the first few hours. Thus we could only remain sitting on the stone bench like prisoners, inactive, discussing the probabilities of the serious movement that had been started in favor of a change of rule. The people apparently looked to me as their rescuer from this oppression, Omar observed one day when we were laying plans for the future. I will, if Zomara favors me, do my best. It is but right, nay, it is your duty towards your subjects to preserve the traditions of the Sanams, I said. Goliba was right when he promised he would show us the horrors introduced into Mo, or resuscitated by the present Naya. We have witnessed with our own eyes expressions of pleasure cross her countenance as each batch of her subjects cast themselves into those yawning jaws. Such a monarch, capable of any cruelty, must necessarily rule unjustly and should be overthrown or killed. I do not desire her death, he said quickly. All I intend to do is to free our people from this hateful reign of terror and at the same time preserve my mother's life. But the time she gave us to quit the country has elapsed, I observed. If we are now discovered, we shall either be held as slaves, or treated without mercy, offered as sacrifices to the crocodile god, perhaps. Not while the people are in our favor, he said. Once their adherence to my cause has been tested, then we have naught further to fear, for the opinion of the populace will be found even of greater power than the military, and in the end it must prevail. In the fight that must ensue thou wilt find thy servant Kona at thy side, the headman said. Through fire or across water, the Dagombas will follow thee, for their fetish is good, and they have faith in thee as leader. Yea, O friend, the young prince answered, without thee and thy followers I could never have returned hither. I owe everything to thee, and to the stout heart of our companion Skarsmir. No, O fellow, I protested. It is your own dogged courage that has pulled us through so far, not mine. Up to the present all has gone well with us, except the deplorable loss of some of our dark companions. Therefore let us retain our light hearts, and meet all obstacles with smiles. I am ready to lead the people against the forces of malice and oppression at any moment Goliba commands, Omar answered. No thought of fear shall arrest my footsteps or stay my hand. Times without number we discussed the situation in similar strain, until on the 11th day of our voluntary confinement we were startled by a low tapping on the door. Each held his breath. Had it been Goliba, he would have entered without any such formality. In silence we remained listening. Again the tap was repeated, louder than before. Drawing our knives, ready to defend ourselves, believing it to be one of the Naya's jailers, Kona went forward, unbolted the door, and opening it a few inches, weapon in hand, peered out. Instantly an exclamation of surprise escaped him, and as he threw wide open the door, a young girl of about 17, with a face more beautiful than I had ever before seen, entered our cell. This vision of feminine loveliness entranced us. We all three stood staring at her open-mouthed. Dressed in a robe of rich blue silk, heavily embroidered with gold, her waist was confined by a golden girdle wherein were set some magnificent rubies, and her feet were encased in tiny slippers of pale green leather, embroidered with seed pearls. Her face, slightly flushed in confusion at finding herself in the presence of the prince, was pale of complexion as my own, her clear eyes a deep blue, her cheeks dimpled, her chin just sufficiently pointed to give a touch of piquancy to a decidedly handsome countenance. Her hair, of almost flaxen fairness, fell in profusion about her shoulders and breast, almost hiding the necklets of gold and gems encircling her slim throat. Little wonder, then, was it that Kona's black visage should broaden into a wide grin in manner habitual when his eyes fell upon anything that pleased him, or that I should regard her as a most perfect type of feminine loveliness.
"I seek Omar the Prince," she said in a silvery voice, not, however, without some trepidation.
"I am Omar," answered my friend. "Who, pray, art thou, that thou shouldst know of my hiding-place?"
"Thy servant," she said with a graceful bow, "is called Leola, daughter of Goliba, counselor of the great Naya. My father sendeth thee greeting and a message."
"Goliba's daughter," Omar cried, laughing, "and we had drawn knives upon thee."
"Sheath them," she answered, smiling upon us. "Keep them in your belts until ye meet your enemies, for ere long ye will, of a verity, want them."
"What then hath transpired?" asked the son of the great white queen. "What message sendeth our friend Goliba?"
"My father directed me to come hither, for knowing the wife of the keeper of the prison, I was enabled to pass the sentries where my father would have been remarked," she said. "He sendeth thee word to be of good courage, for all goeth well, and thy cause prospereth. The savages who accompanied thee into our land are all in safety, although the horsemen of the Naya are scouring the country in search of thee and thy companions. In secret, word of thy consent to lead the popular demonstration against oppression and ill government hath been conveyed to the people, even to our land's furthermost limits, and the reports from all sides show that thou art regarded with favor."
"And thou art also one of my partisans, eh?" asked Omar, smiling.
"I am, O master," she answered, blushing deeply. "I will make fetish for the success of thine arms."
"I thank thee, Leola," he answered. "Thou hast indeed brought us good tidings."
"But my father sendeth thee a further message," she continued. "He told me to tell thee that at sundown today he will come and conduct thee hence. Rest and sleep until then, for the way may be long and great vigilance may be demanded."
"Whither does he intend to take us?" our companion answered.
"I know not, O master," she replied. "Already the people have armed and are assembling. I heard my father in conversation last night with one of the provincial governors who hath lately joined us, declare that the struggle could not be much longer delayed."
"Then thou meanest that a fight is imminent?" he asked.
"I fear so. Word of thine intention hath been conveyed by some spy unto the Naya, and the city now swarmeth with her soldiers and janissaries, who have orders to suppress the first sign of any insurrection. But in the fight thou shalt assuredly win, for the opinion of the people is in thy favor. May Zomara's jaws close upon thine enemies, and may they be devoured like sacrifices."
"The people are assembling, thou hast said," Omar observed. "Are they in great numbers?"
"It is impossible to tell. The news of thine opposition to the Naya spread like wildfire through the land, and secret agents soon ascertained that the balance of opinion was in thy favor. For 8 days past I have been at work secretly in thy cause, and from my own observations in the city I know that among the palace officials we have many adherents, and even here and there the soldiers will turn against their own comrades. In our own house arms and ammunition are stored, and we have been fortunate enough in obtaining from the arsenal through the governor, who is on our side, 10 of those wonderful guns of the English that fire bullets like streams of water."
"Maxims, I suppose," I interrupted.
"I know not their name," she replied. "I heard my father say that they are most deadly, and with them we might hold an army at bay."
"Truly thy father hath neglected nothing on my behalf," Omar said with sincerity. "Dost thou return unto him?"
"I go at once." Then tell him we are anxious to accompany him, and will be ready at sundown.
Thy words will I convey to him, O Master. Liola shall make great fetish for thine ascent to the Emerald Throne.
Then, wishing us adieu, the slim, handsome girl with the deep blue expressive eyes slipped out of the door and noiselessly crept away down the long stone corridor.
"Of a truth, O Master, there can be no fairer daughter on earth than Liola," Kona observed, addressing Omar when the pretty messenger had gone. "Yea, she is beautiful. Her face is like the lily, and her eyes as mysterious as the depths of the sea."
"I have never encountered one so fair," Omar answered.
"Nor I said. "Her beauty is incomparable."
"I had no idea old Goliba had a daughter," Omar exclaimed.
"He is indeed fortunate to have one so amazingly lovely."
"She is one of your partisans," I observed, smiling.
And he laughed, while Kona, grinning with glee, declared chafingly that the prince had fallen in love with her. The subject, however, was not further pursued, but now and then Omar would express a hope that she had returned in safety to her father, or wonder why she had been working in his cause, his words showing plainly that his head was still filled with thoughts of our pretty visitor. Soon after the light had faded from the tiny chink above, Goliba's voice was heard calling outside, and we at once opened the door to him.
"Let us hasten, O Master," the old sage cried breathlessly. "Every instant's delay meaneth peril, and peril is first cousin to disaster."
"Lead," I cried, "we will follow."
A moment later we all four were creeping softly along the corridor past doors of the foul-reeking dungeons wherein those who, for some cause or another, often the most trivial, had fallen into disfavor with the Naya, and were rotting in their silent living tombs. Many were the grim and fearful stories of injustice and agony those black walls could tell. Many were the victims consigned there, although innocent of any offense, never again to see the light of day. As we walked, huge gray rats, some the pets of the wretched prisoners, scurried from our path, and now and then, as we passed the small closed door of heavy sheet iron, the groans and lamentations of the unhappy captives reached our ears. At last, after traversing many passages, turning to the right and left in such a manner that the extent of the great place amazed us, we ascended a flight of well-worn steps. "The sentries now on guard are loyal to us," the royal counselor whispered, turning to Omar as we went up. And when we emerged into the chamber wherein stood the Emerald Throne, the three tall soldiers with drawn swords, two standing mute and motionless as statues on either side of the door, and the other pacing up and down, took no notice of our appearance, but regarded us with stolid indifference. In the rosy evening light, we sped across the beautiful court to a gate opposite, and passed out by a private way of which Goliba held the key, until we found ourselves beyond the frowning walls. Kona looked around longingly as we passed through the courts and chambers. He was anticipating with eagerness the time when he and his men would re-enter the place as conquerors, and was probably reflecting upon the amount of loot his men could obtain in the event of an order being given to sack the palace of the dreaded Naya. But without pausing to glance behind, our guide hurried us forward along a number of winding back streets of the city, hot, dusty, and close-smelling after the broiling day, until he stopped before the door of a fine house, the walls of which were of polished white marble, that reflected the last rays of the sun like burnished gold. Striking the door thrice, it opened, and on going in, he conducted us to a spacious hall, where we found exposed to our view a great collection of arms and warlike accoutrements, all kinds of instruments of death, which the inventive malice of man had ever discovered, had been collected for the use of those determined to accomplish the overthrow of the wicked rule of the Naya. First, there were sticks, staves, and knotty clubs. Next to these, spears, darts, javelins, armed with brass or iron, and their points hardened with fire, and innumerable bows with quivers and arrows, which Kona examined critically, giving low grunts of approbation as he scrutinized the specimen of each. After these, instruments of dubious use originally designed for the assistance of man, but perverted through cruelty and malice to the service of slaughter and death, such as knives, scythes, axes, and hammers. On these were heaped arms deliberately fashioned for the offense of mankind,
swords, daggers, poignards, scimitars, and rapiers, while on the opposite side of the spacious place were stored the more refined and destructive instruments of European war, rifles, muskets, revolvers, bayonets, small field pieces, machine guns of various patterns, including four Maxims and their food, boxes of cartridge, kegs of powder, cakes of dynamite, bombs and shells. "Behold," exclaimed Goliba, halting before them, "here is one of our secret stores of arms."
"One of them?" said Omar. "How many, then, have we?"
"In the city there are 16, all similarly filled. Away in various parts of the country there are depots in every populous center," he replied.
"But it must have taken a long time to obtain all these," the prince observed, puzzled.
"The munitions of war were swiftly obtained for a popular rising," the aged sage replied. "When the word went forth in secret to the people, they responded almost to a man. Arms were actually carried from the royal arsenal in great quantities, and even the spies of the Naya found themselves thwarted and powerless. We have obtained nearly all the Maxims purchased in England by the Naya's agent, Makana. Some are here, others at various depots, and each will be in charge of fighting men who know their use. The few remaining in the arsenal and forts have all been disabled by those of our sympathizers in government employ. Truly," I said, turning to Omar, "the Naya who gave an order for your assassination is seated on the edge of a volcano."
"Yes," cried the white-bearded old counselor, "the country hath struggled and groaned long and in vain under the Naya's tyrannical sway. The uprising will be swift and revengeful."
"When will it occur?" I asked with eagerness.
"Tonight," answered Goliba, in a quiet tone.
"Tonight?" we all three cried, amazed that the preparations were already complete.
"Yes," he said in a low tone. "As the bell on the palace gate chimeth the midnight hour, a great mine will be fired that will proclaim with the earth's sudden upheaval the rising of the people of Mo against their ruler. Then the people, ready armed with these weapons, will strike such a blow as will sweep away all oppression and tyranny from our land, and leave it free as it hath ever been, free to prosper and retain its position as the only unconquered nation on the face of the earth."
End of chapter 25. Recording by Tom Weiss, TomsAudiobooks.com.